everybody, and welcome to another edition of Second Sunday Books. I'm Libby Hellman, and I've got a very special guest with me tonight. It's someone whom we've known each other, it's got to be like 20 years, but we haven't seen each other forever. I don't know, or you were just passing in, like ships passing in the night. It's Les Edgerton, and he's got a new book coming out in December, which is going to knock your socks off. At least it knocked my socks off, and I'm still not wearing them. Before we get going, I just have one little housekeeping chore to get straight, and that is to tell you that this is a trademark copyrighted podcast owned solely by the Authors on the Air Global Radio Network, which just means don't take it unless you ask us first. Okay. So, Les, what you been doing for the past 20 years? No.
Oh, I can't talk about it. It's real personal.
Oh, excuse me. Okay. All right. Well, tell me, hard times, when you sent me that copy, I started reading it to say, okay, well, I'll read a couple of pages, you know, and, you know, get it done because you're an old friend and everything. A day later, I finished the book. I literally did not put it down. It was just
that sounds so good to me. You always want to hear those kind of things, but exactly. Rarely do.
Yeah, well, you did.
Thank you.
You caught me up, and it wasn't that I didn't know what you were doing. I mean, after this much amount of time, I know when a writer is leading me someplace. But boy, was I willing to follow you. And everybody who's watching or listening to this, Hard Times is just one of those books you have to read. It's not a long read, and it's an easy read in terms of the prose because you're such a fine writer.
Well, thank you.
Tell me about it. Where did the idea come from?
Well, actually, my agent, Svetlana Pironko, she's a Russian immigrant to Dublin. I got an overseas agent because it seems like most of my fans are in Europe, and she's got offices in Dublin and Paris. She read a short story of mine in my first collection, Monday's Meal, and she told me one day about a year or so ago, she said, Les, this short story has haunted me ever since I read it. She says, I wish you'd try to write it, develop this into a novel. Because she says, I think if you can carry it off, it can rival maybe something Cormac McCarthy has done. And I don't know if I did that or not, but what I did is I took that story and another short story in the same collection called The Mockingbird Cafe and kind of melded them together and then came out with a totally new product with those two and in additions I made.
So was Amelia, who is the protagonist of Hard Times, was she in one of the stories?
She was in the Hard Times.
Okay.
I think it was called, one time I titled it A Mother's Love, but I was 12 years old, so I was doing sentimental things then. And then I changed to Hard Times, and I think in the collection it came out as Hard Times, if I remember right.
Oh my gosh. So it had been cooking around for a while.
Oh yeah. All my novels do. I don't know how you work, Libby, for sure, but when I write a novel, it's percolated in my brain can for at least 10 years, sometimes longer.
And what were you trying to tell us, or what did you want to tell us from your point of view?
I didn't have a mother like the one I wrote about. She's a mother I wish I'd had that sacrificed for her kids and everything. My mother didn't. She expected us to sacrifice for her. So it was a mother I wish I'd had but didn't. So you got to create her, and she's a very moral person. My real mother claimed to be moral, claimed to be religious, and she was, but it was all based on her benefit, nobody else's. And it really kind of wrecked my childhood in a lot of ways. So I invented a better mother, if you will. And
I did that with a father figure.
Did you?
In my Ellie books.
Yeah.
Father, you know, everyone says, is Ellie's father like your father? He says, nothing like my father.
Yeah. See, I got to do the same thing with my father. Because my father was a douche too.
Yeah. They can be that way. Anyway. Yeah. So.
That's why we write, isn't it, Libby?
Huh?
That's why we write, isn't it? Our childhoods.
Get it out on paper better than getting it out on.
Make it better. Make it gooder.
Right. So tell me, why was it originally set during the Depression, or did that?
I It was originally set. I never came up with a specific year or anything, but that was the general feeling in my head. And it came from the area I grew up in for a large part in East Texas, a little farther north. And I live in Freeport, which is on the Gulf, and it's set kind of in the Big Thicket, which is a little farther north. But the Big Thicket's always kind of intrigued me. I don't know if you know much about it. It's a huge wooded area in Texas. It's very isolated.
East Texas or West?
East.
So near Abilene?
Yes, between Freeport and Houston.
Oh, okay.
So, okay, but it's north. It's not a go. In fact, Roy Harris was a heavyweight contender that came from there. He fought Floyd Patterson years ago for the heavyweight championship. And he came from the only town in the Big Thicket. It's a town called Cut and Shoot. And the town's named that because that's all there is doing a Saturday night is cut and shoot each other. So it's typical Texas town. It's rough.
Yeah, I got that. And I just loved, you know, the characters. Amelia, you know, she was like a female Job. She couldn't.
Very good.
She couldn't do anything. She made one mistake, and unfortunately, she was naive enough or young enough or
brainwashed enough
to figure out that she had to pay for it for the rest of her life. And so she was prepared to do that. And that's just so not modern. I mean, that's
not modern at all.
Yeah.
But she's a woman pretty much like a lot of the women I knew growing up. In that culture, that's what that culture does. Very moral, very religious, and there's a code that you live by, whether you like or not. You feel you're forced to live by it.
Yeah.
When you marry somebody, it's for good or worse till death do you part. That kind of thing, no matter what.
But then she did her father's bidding, so you know, without really putting up much of a fuss.
Yep.
You know, by marrying this guy, even though she knew that it wasn't, she didn't love him and it wasn't really going to work out.
Yeah, he raped her.
Yeah, I would say, yeah. Yeah.
On her one and only date.
Yeah. So now where did some of the other characters come from? The guy that she really, her first.
Oh, Billy?
Yeah.
He was kind of fabricated. That's probably me. That's who I'd like to be.
Okay.
He's a good guy. He's very honorable, but in a different way. He's a little more contemporary, and he's a little more selfish, which is a good thing.
Yeah, but he was a lawman. He got to be a lawman.
Yeah, and that wasn't his aim. His aim, he was going to be an artist like his family, but he fell in love with Amelia very early, and he just wanted to be near her. Never expecting anything to come of it. The character you might want to ask about is Lucius. The character comes in the last part, the black man. He's based after, I modeled him after a real life guy that saved my life. When I was in prison, you knew I was in prison.
Oh yeah, sure.
And I got my parole, and there's certain things you don't do in prison. One thing is when you get a parole, you don't tell anybody. Because there are a lot of jealous people don't want, if you're getting out, they're jealous that they're going to try to, you know, take you out. And that's what happened to me. I told a lot of people I got my parole. Well, my job was in the barbershop. In fact, that's how I made my living after I got out for about 35, 40 years is cutting hair. I was very good at it and won a lot of stuff and everything. But anyway, I was in the barber school and I told everybody about it. And this black guy got in my chair. On my last week. Well, blacks and whites at that time did not mix at all. I mean, you were friendly. We didn't have the things like they do today. It was a whole different world then, but you just didn't mix. You kept yourself. And he got in my chair and I said, now you're in the wrong chair, man. He says, no, he says, I'm gonna make you my kid, meaning he's gonna make me his punk. And I'd made my mind up a long time ago, if anything like that happened, I was just gonna kill a guy. And so I grabbed my straight razor and went after him with the intent to separate his head from his body, chased him all over the barbershop. We had a black guard, Mr. Jones, everybody called Jonesy. He got to me through threw me into the instructor's office, locked the door, and got the guy and walked him back to his cell house. Now, by all rights, he should have written me up and him up. I would have lost my parole. I would have done the rest of my sentence, and I would have had to kill that guy for sure. And I'd probably been in prison the rest of my life. He literally saved my life because he did not write me up.
Wow.
And at that time, blacks didn't do that for whites and whites didn't do that for blacks, but he did that for me. And he knew the ramifications. It wasn't, I knew he'd saved my life, but it didn't really dawn on me how much he'd done for me until years later. And I always wanted to model a character and a story after him. My only regret is I forgot to include him in my acknowledgments, but his name is Jones. We called him Mr. Jonesy, and he was just a good guy.
So that's Lucas. Okay.
Yeah, that's Lucius. Yeah.
So you're going to take him any other place? You got another story in mind?
Actually, I was going to continue this, but I kind of ran out of town. He's got a daughter. His problem is he's from Detroit, and his daughter had polio, was in an iron lung, and he couldn't afford to take care of her. So he robbed a place to get money, got caught, went to prison at Jackson, escaped from prison, went there, made his way to New Orleans. And that's where we pick him up at. In New Orleans, he gets in a fracas and kills a white cop from Mississippi, is on the run again. That's how he meets Amelia. And they go through their thing. Well, in my mind, I got him, Billy put him on a bus to Mexico to get him out of town because they were going to take his fingerprints, even though it was justified. He did a killing, but he was justified.
Right.
So he helped him get to Mexico, and that's the last we see of him. I was going to take him from Mexico down to Argentina, and then he was going to get into cattle racing, become rich, and then come back and get contact with Amelia. And he was going to have her help him get his daughter, if she was still alive, and bring her to Argentina.
What? You're still going to do that? Of course.
It's in my mind. It's got to percolate a little longer before I can write it.
Great.
But I just didn't have time to include that this time.
Yeah. And,
you know, but I think it would be a good sequel.
It's just a companion book.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't even have to be a tight sequel, but
yeah,
the same characters come back. That would be terrific. You've already got me excited about that. So tell me something.
I'll have to write.
Before prison, before you were published, how did you know you wanted to become a writer?
Oh, that's easy. When I was five, I taught myself to read. My grandmother read to me all the time, and one day I just continued a sentence. So I learned to sight read, and very quickly she taught me phonics and everything, and I learned to read. Well, the first book I read on my own, I liked it, but I thought I could do better than this. And I knew right then I was going to be a writer. I've never wavered for a second from that. I knew immediately. Well, I couldn't write as good a book as that at the time, but now I think I can. But in my idea of becoming a writer was the Jack London School of Writing. You went out and had experiences and wrote about them.
Yeah.
And then a few years, so that's what I've done all my life. I've sought out experiences, preferably bad ones, negative ones, so I'd have material. And a few years ago, I read an interview with Flannery O'Connor, where she told the interviewer, she said, if you live in the same little town, in the same little house for the first 17 years of your life, you have all the material you'll ever need as a writer. And I thought, I wish I'd read this years ago. It would have saved me a lot of grief.
That's funny. Did you see, there was just a documentary on about her.
Oh, was it? I missed it.
Yeah.
I'm a huge fan of hers.
Somebody sent me the link. I haven't even watched it yet. Mm-hmm. I'll send it to you after this interview. So what was the first thing that you did that got you published? How did you get published the first time?
Well, I didn't know how to get published, but I'd been writing all my life. In fact, I had three novels I wrote when I was in a joint. When I left, they confiscated them. Actually, there was one about, I called Marauders, and it was about a plague caused by a virus, which would have been very timely.
Oh my God.
But in those days, you had to send a manuscript in with postage there and in return postage. Yeah. And it usually ran about $20 for an entire manuscript, 11 bucks each way. And I had one copy, and this publisher asked for it in New York. I sent my only copy. I'd never done that before or since. I got a letter 3 months later, said they'd gone bankrupt. My book was in a warehouse with the others. And if I could send money, they could send it back. I didn't have the money.
Oh, wow.
I was very poor, and it's gone. But it mirrors exactly what we're doing today with it. And I would have had it out 30 years ago.
What about now? Why don't you see if you could put a trace on it? You're a good detective. You could find out where it is.
No, I'm sure it's destroyed. It was in a warehouse and I'm sure I don't remember the publisher anymore.
Oh wow. That's
so it's gone.
So it's gone, but you obviously got published anyway.
Yeah. I didn't know how to get published and I had stacks and stacks of stuff. In my collection, Money's Mule, probably half of those stories I wrote when I was 12, 13 years old, they just sat around and I didn't know how to get published. We didn't have the internet in those days, you know, so you had to learn the hard way how to do things. And I was selected for a workshop with Tim O'Brien in Indianapolis. And I went down there and they picked five of us with our novels. And he looked at mine. He had me go outside with him during the break. He was a big smoker and so was I. I smoked Camel regulars and he smoked Marlboros. And he brought five packs to the meeting. I brought five packs and we smoked them all during the thing. So anyway, that's why I've got COPD and all this other crap. But anyway, he said, Les, he said, I love your manuscript. He says, you remind me so much of Raymond Carver. And I didn't know who Raymond Carver was. Anyway, I got my first book published, a collection of short stories. And the New York Times reviewer compared me to Raymond Carver too. And then I had to go read him. And I thought, yeah, I like this guy. And I saw what they saw, but I didn't learn from him. I just saw it. And that's just what I did, the way I wrote.
So you never really had any special instruction in writing? That was just...
Oh yeah, I read.
Yeah, you read.
That's how you learn to write.
Of course, yeah.
I've got an MFA and give me 50 cents and a cup of coffee and I'll give you my MFA for what that's... And it's from a good school. It's from Vermont College. But I think the only way you learn to write is to read.
Absolutely.
I really do.
Yeah, no, I totally agree with you there. So you know, you probably, I don't even know if you remember how much you helped me with a short story.
Oh, a little bit. I don't know if I helped you that much or not, but you're very kind to say so.
Like Pendleton. Mm-hmm. And it was a young black man and a Ku Klux Klan prisoner.
Uh-huh.
They forged this unusual relationship. Sure. And
not as unusual as you think.
Well, it ended up being pretty noir, but got right into this anthology where they were looking for a kind of offbeat story. Mm-hmm. So I have to thank you for that.
Very welcome. I'm sure I didn't do as much as you're giving me credit for.
Yeah, you did.
You're a pretty fair country writer, Libby.
You did. You got me thinking and writing about all sorts of things a nice Jewish girl should never think about.
Yeah, I see so much incorrect and bad information about prisons. That MSNBC series where they go into the joint is so BS. All this show are the weightlifters and the wackos. Most criminals don't lift weights. We're lazy. That's why we're criminals and don't have a 9-to-5 job. We don't want to do that kind of work. It's the guys that are getting picked on in lifting weights. They do the Charles Atlas thing, but
I sent me your book about being in prison. I think I remember reading it.
Well, I've got my memoir came out last year.
Oh no,
Tunnel and Junkie, and then I did Just Like That, which is based on some experiences. It's probably Just Like That. Yeah.
Yeah, that was the one. Yeah, I found it really riveting.
But it's all changed nowadays. When I was there, it reflected the population in general. We had about 10% blacks, about 90% whites, and I don't remember any Hispanics in Indiana. And we were the single worst prison in the United States, according to Lyndon Johnson.
I remember you telling me that
that was a big deal. They did he commissioned a study when he was president to study all the prisons in the United States. And it one day we're all sitting in the rec room. We had one black and white TV. Every other night we got to go out and sit in the rec room and watch I Love Lucy reruns. And no TVs in your cells and everything like you got it today. Anyway, he broke into a program and announced that they'd done an extensive study. They discovered that Pendleton was the single worst prison in the United States. And we all got up and cheered like our Super Bowl just won. Our team had just won a Super Bowl.
Yeah.
But and there wasn't a Super Bowl at that time yet.
It's ironic. I have a very good friend who unfortunately just started a 5-year federal sentence.
Federal?
Federal.
They'll do the whole bit then.
Yeah.
It's the whole time.
I know. He's in Texarkana.
Mm. It's a lot easier state time, no, trust me. None of it's good, but it's a lot state time is bad time.
Yeah.
So I was in 8 riots in my 3 years.
Oh, great. Well, wonderful. You didn't get it.
You have riots, not for the reasons they show on TV. You have riots so you can make Pruno. Oh. It's a homemade brew you make with yeast and sugar and fruit, and you sterilize your toilet and you put it in your toilet. It's got to sit in there for 3 or 4 days, and you have a riot so everybody can make Pruno. Otherwise, they're searching your cell every day. You don't get a chance to. That's what riots are about.
Oh my God, I had no idea.
You take over for a while, make Pruno, get drunk, and then go back to normal. They come in, shoot a few people, and then you go back to normal.
Anyway, tell me, you've written a lot of short stories as well as your novels. Which do you like better? Which do you find is a more interesting?
I guess I like them both the same. I quit writing short stories because there's no money in them.
Yeah.
I mean, that genre has changed immensely. And a lot of people mistake. They think short stories or novels are longer short story, and they're not at all. It's an entirely different structure. Mm-hmm. Short stories, novels, you have to go up the I forget what's called the roller coaster thing, what do you call it? There's a diagram.
Oh, right. The suspense. Well, it
yeah. And the falling off and all that you still have in a novel.
Yeah.
Rising. But not in short stories anymore.
Right.
Because the publishing gods, whoever they are, have decreed that we know all the general, the great truths. So you can't have great truths exposed in a short story. Now the diagram would be this little blip, and you have a small central truth that needs to be exposed in a short story, and that's it. Yeah. So they're very, very, a lot easier to write, and I enjoy them. I don't like reading short stories because if I really like the work, I want to read a long version of it. So, and sure. The way they do short stories today, there's a lot of cheap-ass short stories out there, trust me, that aren't well-written because of the internet. Because it used to be the only way you got a collection was you had to have at least half the short stories published in good literary journals. Today, that's nobody cares about that anymore. They just throw out a collection. Yeah. And most of them are crap, in my opinion.
Yeah, so tell me something. getting back to hard times, did you know how it was going to end before you wrote it, or as you wrote it, or are you the kind of writer that
usually I know the ending before I know anything? And that one I didn't. I had a general idea what was going to happen, but I didn't know until I got close to the end. And I like to write like that. And in fact, that's what I tell my students. I have a novel writing class that goes on constantly and online. And that's what I tell my students. The best way to write, I think, is get your protagonist in the worst possible fix you can think of. You don't know how they can get out. There's no way possible to get them out. And then you'll come up with a solution. That way, writing it's like reading it. You don't know what's going to happen. And that's what I did. I've done that for years and years and years. And I've learned to trust the process. And what I do, I keep paper and pencil everywhere I go. And I especially have one there near my bed on my nightstand. And when I'm in a fix like that in a book, the last thing I do before I go to sleep is think about the problem. And most of the time it comes to me while I'm asleep, I'll wake up and real quickly write it down. But you got to learn to trust the process. And people don't, they want a sure thing. You want to be sure I'm going to. And that's why a lot of books I think are kind of dull, because that's the way they're written.
Yeah. Yeah.
They're too planned out.
This one that I wrote was a real change for me. It isn't a mystery. It isn't a crime story, unless you consider war a crime. And I wasn't married to, you know, the structure of the plot of a mystery. I could do whatever I wanted. And that really freaked me out at the beginning, because I'm like, what am I going to say? But so much research. I went there. And then after I did research there. And then when I got home, I would come up with these little nuggets that really surprised me, that I didn't know about the war. I didn't know about Vietnam. I figured, well, if I didn't know them and I was pretty active during the war, maybe other people would like them too. And somehow it just wrote itself. And it was so much easier than mm-hmm. I thought it was going to be, you know, once I got going.
Yeah.
I was gonna, oh my God, you know, when a mystery, you're like, oh, you got to do this clue, and then you got to do that red herring, and then you got to, you know, make sure that the
crisis. Right.
And I didn't have to. I felt like it was almost organic. It was different. It was really different. And I liked it a lot. So
you'll do that for your next one. What is your next one going
to
be?
I think I'm going to go back to my hard-boiled female detective.
Are you?
Yeah.
Everybody loves those. So
yeah, I've been away from her for
three years. I put off reading your book because I was a Vietnam guy.
Yeah.
And I bore the brunt when I came back. People spit on us and all that crap. And it shocked us because we were just fighting for our country. That's all we were doing. Actually, what happened in 64, Johnson signed the Gulf of Tonkin resolution, but we had been in it before that. And actually, France got into it in 1945, right after World War II. So it's been a war over there forever.
They colonized Vietnam.
Exactly.
There's some really interesting things about the Vietnamese as a people because they were colonized by the French. That mm-hmm. in Southeast Asia, Vietnamese people were always considered desired employees for companies mm-hmm. because they could all read.
Sure.
They were somewhat cultured.
Yeah.
Because of the French education.
Sure.
And because they were industrious and. Yeah. So if you were in China or the Philippines or even, you know, Thailand, you always wanted a Vietnamese person to work for you. Mm-hmm.
They, when they immigrated to America, a lot of them came to Freeport, where I'm from. They worked on shrimp boats down there.
Yeah.
The huge contingent went to Freeport and up and down the Texas coast. So.
Know that agent. Yeah, the story that I'm written has not a whole lot to do with the U.S. It's about mm-hmm. the two Vietnamese girls and how they survive.
You should read one of my students published her first novel. It's called A Plum Blooms in Winter. And it's about a Japanese girl. The guy did the Doolittle raids, dropped bomb on her hometown, killed her brother and all this. And she has a family honor to go back and kill. And this guy, it's based on a true story. And this guy was on a raid, got religion after the war, became a minister, and traveled to Japan as a missionary. And this is all true story it's based on. And actually, the widow of this guy is alive, and she wouldn't give her permission to use her name. So she had to write it as fiction. But anyway, it's a powerful story, and how she gets saved, and that's the true story. When she went to hear him speak, she was going to stab him. And she got saved during the meeting and became a proselytizer herself. It's a powerful story.
Yeah, forgiveness is a powerful thing.
Yeah, I can't do it.
I'm not sure I can either, but it's
not with my parents.
It's a goal worth aspiring to.
Yes, as you.
Yeah, it's a goal.
No, you're right.
So what's next for you?
Well, a bunch of stuff. I've got a children's story. It's been stuck in my head for 20 years. And I just ran into a friend of mine it's about a squirrel. It's my only children's story I ever wanted to write. And I proposed to her that we co-write it. She got very excited about it. And so we're probably going to work on that. I've got a new craft book I'm talking to Danny Gardner at Brownsville about. It's based on Thelma and Louise, which I think is the most perfect piece of writing ever written. Oh, yeah. I think every single scene in that movie is a perfect teaching moment. I can't think of one single thing wrong with that. And I've seen it over 300 times. I teach it. And everybody I've showed it to and taught said, you should need to write a book in it. So I'm hoping I get a chance to do that. And I've got two novels.
Would it be analysis of the screenplay and the story?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
And what
idea?
I had it sold to Writer's Digest at one time for a 10,000 advance, which is what they've always given me. And I had to pull it for a number of reasons. One, they wanted to include other movies. I said, no, I want to do it in this one movie because I find other movies that have parts of it, but nothing that has everything you want in a novel. It's perfect. It really is perfect. And so that's what I want to write it on. And then I've got two novels, and both of them are about hitmen. And that one I talked to you about, but The others are, one's going to be an encyclopedia of perfect crimes, because this guy kills wealthy people, their mates, to make them look like accidents.
True crime?
No, it's fiction.
Oh, okay.
But it will be an encyclopedia for perfect crimes, because they are perfect.
Oh, great.
I thought a lot about crime. Any criminal does. And I thought I could give an example for one thing, if you want one.
Sure.
Well, the one he's on now, he's going to get this guy wants to kill his wife, who he married, and she owns textile mills in Vermont, and a lot of money. And that's what these crimes are all about. They're all give somebody money from their mates. So what he does, he goes to their house. He always disguises himself. And this one, he disguises himself as a Hispanic from New Orleans, which is where he's based out of. And he goes to dinner with the guy and his wife, and he wants to find out something about him. And he finds out that she's an outdoors person. So he comes up with this crime. He goes to LSU, breaks in, and gets rabies. They do rabies research here, and gets rabies germs or whatever from these animals. Comes back up, and then he has a husband take her on a trip to these cabins. And well, he doesn't do it. It changes. But anyway, this is how it's laid out. They have dinner one night, and what he's going to do, he's going to drug the wife that he's going to kill. And while she's sleeping, he's going to take the rabies infection and insert it between her toes. Be a very small incision. The thing about rabies, you don't know you have it for several days. And once you know you have it, it's too late. So he's going to keep her up there until it's too late. He's also even injected mice and killed them and put them in the floorboards and stuff. So if anybody ever does an investigation, they'll say, oh, it must have been a mouse. Yeah. Right. And but he doesn't do it to her, because the wife catches him. She's sharper. And he ends up working for her, doing the same thing to her husband. But that's just one example of about 15. I've got a perfect crime. I mean, perfect crimes.
That's good. I like that. That's great. We are just about out of time, but this is just...
Oh, no.
It's been a pleasure. It's been really fun to catch up. This is and Hard Times is just wonderful.
Well, thank you.
Everybody, you want to hold?
I love my cover.
Yeah, it's perfect. So, don't move it. Perfect. No glare. It's great. Wonderful. And if anybody is looking for a Christmas gift and one of your reader friends, you definitely need to get that person Hard Times.
And you should probably buy two copies, because you'll think of somebody else last minute you got another one for.
Exactly. Thanks so much for being here with us, Les. And thank you everybody for tuning in and listening and watching. And I will be back in a little while with another edition of Second Sunday Books.
Libby, thank you so much. You're one of my heroes.
Thank you.
See you in church.